Final speaker for today is María García Díaz, and she will talk to us about resurrecting Clausius, why nanomachines are more efficient than we thought. Excellent. Take it away.
Okay. Thank you. So I am a postdoc researcher at the Universitat Autònoma de Barcelona with Professor Ana Sampera, and today I would like to tell you about this work that I did in collaboration with my colleagues Philip Strasberg and Andreu Riera. So first of all, let us briefly explain why we want to bring Clausius back to life. So in classical thermodynamics, normally what you consider is a large system that is in contact to an infinite bath, no? As Giorgio, among other speakers, explained to us this morning, it is possible to write down the second law for this kind of system bath in this way, okay? So you know that the total entropy production of the universe must be positive, meaning that the contributions of the change in entropy of the system plus the change in entropy of the bath need to be positive. There is another way of writing this down, in particular, using the Clausius inequality, okay, that he derived in already back in 1865, where we write the difference in the entropy of the bath in this integral form, okay? So as you know, this dQ would be the differential heat flux from the bath into the system. This time-dependent temperature would be the time-dependent temperature of your bath. And this over here is just the change in the entropy of your system. What happens if you consider your bath to have a constant temperature? Well, in this case, you can take this T of T out of the integral and you remain with this simple expression over here. So we are denoting, as you see, as sigma entropy production, okay, the sum of these two terms. And when we restrict to constant bath temperatures, we are denoting it as sigma prime, okay? Now, with the advent of quantum thermodynamics, it is already possible to consider systems that are much smaller in size. However, here the still usual assumption is that they are in contact with infinite baths, okay? In this case, well, this is the normal thermalization setting, no, that you would have. You would have your system that you make it interact with your infinite bath, and then you let it thermalize. At some point, then the system acquires the temperature of the bath, and then since the bath is infinite and its state hasn't changed in time, it is possible for you to detach your system from your bath, okay? Fortunately, the second law, okay, is derivable also in this microscopic setting, okay, in this way. For that, we have to make the following assumptions. First assumption, that you start with system and bath totally decorrelated, okay, and you consider your bath to be in equilibrium, okay. I denote with this pi the thermal state, the Gibbs state, at some fixed temperature T0 that, as I said, remains constant over time. Then we measure the entropy using the von Neumann entropy. And then we assume that we measure the heat by means of the difference in the energy of the bath, okay? Okay, but now, recently, quantum thermodynamics has also allowed us not only to consider small systems, but also small baths, okay, finite baths. In particular, this experiment over here is very illustrative. Here we have two finite baths made of ultra-cold atoms. So one bath is in a hotter temperature than the other one. And both baths are made to interact by means of a channel. And what we see here is that there is an exchange of particles, okay, between one bath to the other, meaning that the chemical potential of these finite baths changes in time and also their temperature until it reaches a point of thermalization when both the chemical potential and the temperature stabilize to some point. Okay, so what is meaningful here is to see that whenever you have finite baths, this assumption that the temperature of the bath is constant no longer applies, okay? Until it reaches equilibrium, there is a moment, okay, there is a period of time when the temperature of the bath cannot be considered to be constant. Good news is that even in this case, it is possible to rederive Clausius inequality, the second law, Okay. For that, the assumptions we must make are the same as before, and we need to include an extra assumption that is this one over here. Okay. So this assumption is very important. It regards the what temperature, what time dependent temperature we need to fix in here in this integral, and basically in order to find it, we need to impose this. No, we need to impose that the mean energy of your bath is the same as the mean energy it would have in the hypothetical case that it would have been in equilibrium. Okay, so we are not imposing that our bath is in equilibrium. We are only imposing that its energy behaves as if it were in equilibrium. Okay, so you solve this equation and then you find the function t of t that you can plug in here. Okay. Nice. So as a very brief summary of this first part, okay, so we wrote down the entropy production in two cases. First case, when you have when you consider your temperature to be time dependent. Second case, when you consider your temperature to be constant. Then we saw that when you have an infinite bath, okay, this entropy production can be considered a faithful second law, of course. Also here, when you consider constant temperature of your bath, but then we wanted to point out that there is a problem, no, when you consider finite baths, because normally what you take as second law, no, what has been taken as second law in the literature when you have finite baths is this expression over here. But this expression over here, it should only be valid when you have a constant temperature in your bath, no? But in general, this is not true as experiments like the one we mentioned before prove, no? So then the main message of this talk and of this work is that we would like to advocate for the use of this reformulation of Clausius inequality of the second law when it comes to having finite paths. Okay. So this was the first main message of the talk. And then we move to part two. Now that Clausius has resurrected in order to correctly quantify the second law when you have finite paths. So what are the consequences? What are the practical consequences of this? Okay, so first of all, the irreversibility of our protocol depends on whether you choose sigma or sigma prime to account for your second law, okay? In particular, what we prove in the work is that the difference between the sigma prime and the sigma, so the entropy productions with constant temperature in the bath and with non-constant temperature in the bath, can be quantified by the relative entropy, D, between these two thermal states. The thermal state at temperature, at final temperature, and the thermal state at initial temperature. Since the relative entropy is always positive, then we have that sigma prime is always larger or equal than sigma. So the entropy production when you have constant temperature in your bath is higher than when you have time-dependent temperature in your bath. Meaning that if you are dealing with a finite bath and you consider that it has a constant temperature, then you will see more irreversibility in all the protocols that you perform there than if you had considered your bath to have a time-dependent temperature. Okay, so then, okay, so you see, as I said, less irreversibility, no, than previously thought. So first application of this principle, it concerns heat engines. So a very brief introduction to heat engines. What is a heat engine? You have two baths, one cold, one is hot, and then you bring a system and you make it interact with both of them. After the interaction has taken place, you take it away and you apply a unitary operation on your system with the aim to obtain some useful work. What do you do afterwards? You bring the system back into the engine. And then you repeat this cycle over and over again. As you see, it's a cyclic process where the Hamiltonian of the system is the same at the initial of the protocol and at the end of the protocol, okay? So then, how do we define the efficiency of a heat engine? So normally, traditionally, you define efficiency for a heat engine where the baths are infinitely large and they have constant temperature. How do you do that? Well, you want to know what is the ratio between the thing that you want to extract, okay, that is minus the work. Remember that the work, we are defining negative when you extract it from the system. So if you put this negative sign over here, you just ensure that this efficiency is always positive. So you want to know what is the ratio, no, between the useful work you want to extract and the dissipated and the amount of heat that you have to invest. But we have a problem now, no? And it is that when you consider finite baths, you cannot ensure that your temperature will always be constant. So how do we define efficiency in this case? Well, we have come up with a procedure that I would like to convey to you now. So imagine you have a quantity, we call it sigma, that is made up of the sum of two terms, A and B. This quantity is positive. And basically you are interested in extracting one of these terms, for example, A. A must be negative, no, by definition, because you extract it from the system. And this is the useful quantity that you want to extract. Then, in order to do it, you will have to invest something, no? You will have to invest a positive quantity B. How do we define efficiency in this case? Well, by dividing A over B, okay? This can be rewritten in this way and can be proven to be smaller or equal to 1. This, to begin with, is good news, okay? Because notice that we want to compare the efficiency of two heat engines, okay? One with finite baths and the other with infinite baths. So one with constant temperature in the baths and the other with time-dependent temperature in the baths. And in both cases, we want to have the efficiency upper bounded by the same quantity in order to make this comparison faithful and meaningful, no? So this is already a good starting point, that this efficiency that we are defining is always upper bounded by one, by the same quantity. Second step. So imagine we have our heat engine operating in the steady state regime. This means that it has undergone a sufficiently large number of cycles such that the difference in the entropy and in the internal energy of the system is negligible in comparison to other terms. In this case, it is possible to write the first law of thermodynamics like this, and the second law, Clausius inequality, like this. Okay, so you play a little bit with these terms, and you are able to write the entropy production for constant temperature in this way over here. And now we apply our procedure. We identify the quantity that we want to extract, that is the work divided by this factor, the temperature of the cold bath. We call this useful quantity A prime, and then the rest will be the quantity that we will have to pay in order to extract A. Then the ratio of these two quantities gives us the efficiency for this setting. Remember, setting when you consider constant temperature in your bath, eta prime. Now, we move to the setting with time-dependent temperature in the bath, so entropy production can be written in this way, and again, we identify the term that we want to extract, that is this one over here, okay? Again, the work divided by the temperature of the cold bath. This is a second good point, no? It seems in our definition of efficiency, because notice that in both settings, we are comparing exactly the same useful and meaningful quantity, that is this work. Okay, and then the rest is just B, is just the quantity that we have to invest. Dividing A over B, we obtain this efficiency eta. What you are able to show, okay, and this is the nice result, is that the ratio between both of them can be written in terms of the difference in entropy productions. And since this difference, as we saw in the beginning of this part, is negative, okay, then it means that this ratio is upper bounded by one, in particular, the efficiency of a heat engine, where the temperature of the baths is constant is smaller than the efficiency of a similar engine where the temperature of the baths would be time dependent. Okay, so this is one of the first interesting consequences of this that we wanted to illustrate numerically with this example. So in this example, we consider the following heat engine. We have a system that is a two-level system and two baths, okay? One bath is the cold bath and it's infinite. And then the other bath, the hot bath, is finite. And in particular, it is composed of 100 two-level systems. So in the first step, what this engine does is the system thermalizes with the infinite cold bath. And in the second step, the system interacts with one of the two-level systems of the finite bath by means of a swap transformation. Okay, so we repeat these two steps for a number of cycles n that we plot always in the x-axis. This is the number of cycles undergone by the heat engine, and then we plot the entropy production for both cases, so for constant temperature and for non-constant temperature. So as we saw before, no, this shows what we were saying before, that the entropy production when you consider time-dependent temperature is smaller than the one when you consider constant temperature in your bath. But one thing that we see also here, and that is also very interesting, is that the entropy production does not only depend on the size or on the temperature of your bath, because it also depends on the number of cycles undergone by the heat engine. In particular, you see over here, okay, that for sufficiently small number of cycles, the two entropy productions are the same. Okay. And then we do the same here, but in this case, we plot the efficiency of both kind of engines. So first we plot eta prime. This would be the efficiency of the engine when you consider that you have a constant temperature in your finite bath. And if instead you allow this temperature to be time dependent, you see that you obtain this advantage. Okay, you see that the efficiency increases with the number of cycles. Okay. Okay, so this was the first application. Now, the second application I wanted to tell you a bit about concerns information erasure. So here I present schematically what is called the Landauer erasure protocol. So here you have a two-level system where the ground state and the excited state are degenerate, okay? And in particular, you have a mixed state. So you have the same probability of having your system in zero or in one. In the second step, what you do is you break this degeneracy of the energy levels, and you bring one of the states up. By doing this, you increase the probability of having a transition, okay, between one and zero. And in particular, during this transition, you release some heat, no, from the system to the bath. And then in the end, okay, you bring back your level number one, and what you see is that, well, you started having half of the populations in both systems, and in the end, you have most of the populations just in zero. So in this case, you can interpret that you have to erase some of the information in level one, no? Okay. Okay, so this that I have here is Landauer's principle, that basically lower bounds the heat that is dissipated from the system to the bath during an information erasure protocol. It is easily obtained, okay, from this second law for constant temperature in your bath, for sigma prime being positive. Okay, you have this lower bound over here that in particular gives a logarithm, the famous logarithm of two quantity, no, that you obtain when you want to erase one bit of information. But then again, if you consider our Clausius inequality, okay, if you consider that you may have time dependent temperature in your bath, you obtain this other kind of bound, okay, And knowing what we proved before, that sigma prime is larger than sigma, then you can show that, in particular, this bound is tighter than Landauer's own bound, okay? We would like to call it this one, the Landauer's principle for finite paths, no? Okay, and then we wanted to show again numerically this this conclusion. Here we consider a spin that is in contact with a finite path made up of five spins, and we want to carry out a Landauer erasure protocol on this spin. Okay, what we are plotting here is, first of all, the dissipated heat. This is the black line here, and then we just plotted some bounds, some known bounds for this dissipated heat. So the black line over here is Landauer's bound itself, okay, derived already in 1961. You see it differs quite a lot from the true value of the dissipated heat. Then over here, we plotted also two known bounds published in 2014 and 2020 that are valid bounds, that are derivable from valid mathematical inequalities. But then remarkably, what you see is that you if you go back in time, okay, you get an even better bound to the dissipated work in this kind of erasure protocols. Okay, if you plot Clausius inequality, if you plot the bound that arises from Clausius inequality, you get already a bound for the dissipated heat that is quite tight. Okay. And with this, I just want to conclude. So first message of this work is that Clausius inequality correctly quantifies the second law of thermodynamics for finite baths. Okay, in particular, well, remember that we are assuming that this temperature, okay, is an effective temperature that we define by imposing that the mean energy of the bath is the same it would have had it been in equilibrium. And then second conclusion, thanks to this, non-equilibrium processes are actually less irreversible than previously thought. So for that, with that, I just want to thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. Very nice talk. I think there aren't any questions in the Discord, but I did have one question. So if I treat the finite size hot bath as a finite system, why can't I just calculate the free energy change of that system relative to the hot bath? I mean, would that give a similar bound to what you get, or is that a different way thinking about your bound potentially?
Sorry, can you repeat the first part of your question, Paul?
So as soon as if I have a bath which is finite in size, and now I like in your application one, your model engine, you still had kind of one infinite bath and then one finite bath. And yeah, in these cases, I would always be tempted to treat the finite bath as just a non-equilibrium system and calculate its free energy change. And I was just wondering how that compares to your approach, if you've thought about this.
Okay, actually, I have to say we haven't thought about this approach. Okay, so you mean okay, calculating the free energy of the finite bath itself? Okay, as if we were in non-equilibrium, I see.
Okay, maybe we could talk offline then at some point. It would just be, I think it might be just a different way of viewing what you did, but I would be interested to understand the connection, because that would have been my natural way of approaching the problem. But
yeah. Yes, in fact, thanks a lot for pointing this out. We will definitely think about it. Yeah.
Thank you. That will be okay. Nice. Okay, so with that, I guess this brings the session to the close.